transconductance is less sensitive to the transistor parameters, also temperature. And, okay, basically a transistor parameter is also dependent on temperature. Okay, that we saw. In fact, if you fix the drain current, there is no dependence on VT for the transconductors, and even the dependence on the current factor mu and C of W by L is half in the relative sense. Okay, because of the square root. Now, what did we do? There are many options to carry out this biasing. We chose one where we sense the difference between the actual drain current and the desired drain current I naught at the drain of the transistor. And if you do make a connection like this, the difference between I naught and ID makes the drain voltage go up or down. Okay, if I naught is more than ID, then the drain voltage goes up. If I naught is less than ID, the drain voltage goes down and so on. Okay. Now, if you had to vary the gate voltage such that ID matches I naught, you will find that if I naught is more than ID, you have to actually increase this. Okay. So the direction in which you want to move the gate voltage to make ID equal to I naught is exactly how the drain voltage is moving. Okay. So you can complete this feedback through any kind of function that preserves that dependence. Okay. That is, if the drain voltage is increasing, the gate voltage must increase. Okay. And the easiest of such possible connections is a straight connection with a wire. Okay. Now, by the way, like I mentioned, you conceive of any circuit that will do this, that will increase the gate voltage in response to an increasing drain voltage. But after that, you have to check separately whether the transistor remains in saturation, because our idea is for it to be used as an amplifier. Okay. Because the circuit doesn't, by itself, doesn't ensure that, because you could complete the circuit in a variety of ways. Okay. But this particular connection, it does in fact ensure it, because in this case, VDS equals VGS, which is clearly more than VGS minus VT, as long as the threshold voltage is positive. Okay, so this does keep the transistor in the saturation region. Okay, and this business of feeding back from drain to gate is okay, or drain feedback, not very imaginative, but that's what it is. Okay. This will for sure make that, make ID equals I naught, right? Otherwise, there can be no steady state. Otherwise, this difference current will go through the parasitic capacitance, which could be due to wire, due to the MOS transistor itself. The current can go into the MOS transistor in transient, cannot go in steady state. Okay? So, the voltage will go on changing until ID equals I naught. Okay? So, what will be the gate voltage? VGS is greater than VT. It can also be higher. VDS equals VGS, right?
That has to be the VGS
greater
than VT.
Alright, VGS is less than VT, what will be the drain current ID? VGS is less than VT, the transistor would be off. So what would happen is that then clearly I naught is more than 0. So this current being pumped into this node will go on increasing the voltage until VGS increases past VT. Okay. So like I said, the gate of the MOS transistor is a capacitor. So if you imagine a case where everything is off at the beginning and you turn on the current source, what will happen is initially the current will go into the gate to charge up that capacitor. It will get charged to some voltage and then it will go on. But we are not interested in the dynamics of it. We will only look at the steady state where ID has become equal to I. Okay. Any other questions about this? Now, the whole idea was to make an amplifier which is less sensitive to less sensitive to the transistor parameters and temperature and so on. So, we have turned this into a common source amplifier. Okay? I think I defined the common source amplifier, right? Where the source is common terminal to both the input and output sides. So, if you recall, we had this arrangement for setting the operating point. We set this VGS, so let's say 3 volts, and we had some arrangement for VDS as well. Okay, and this one in the signal we have to turn into vi being applied between gate and source, and the load being connected between drain and source. Okay, so this is the signal picture, this is the operating point picture, and we know how to combine those two, right? In the process of that, we came up with this AC coupling and all these other techniques where we can combine signal and bias, we can separate the bias from the signal and so on. Okay, so now we have to do the same thing, except that this is not the operating point picture we are interested in, because that makes the parameters very sensitive to transistor parameters. So we have to combine this operating point picture with that signal picture. Okay, this is fine. So please tell me how I would go about doing it. So this, in the operating point, it should look like this. Meaning, of course, you have to make changes to the circuit because you have to insert the input and the load. But effectively, in the operating point picture, it should look like this. Meaning, the gate should be getting feedback from the drain. Otherwise, it will not get biased, right? Without feedback, it won't get biased. For instance, if you didn't have this, what would happen? Okay, ID is different from I naught. This will go on increasing or decreasing, and the gate voltage is not changing in response to that. So it will either go on reach plus infinity or zero or something. Okay. So we have to have feedback, and in the signal or the incremental picture, we must have the input source, which is represented by a voltage source in series with the resistance, connected between gate and source, and the load connected between drain and source of this transistor. Okay? Now we know that because of practical constraints, and this we encountered before as well, possibly there could be other components here. Okay? So you either, in the best case at least, even if you can't avoid the components themselves, you try to choose their value so that they become negligible. Okay, for instance, previously when we combined this with that, we also had some resistance to ground, right? That came out because we had to bias the transistor, R1 parallel R2, that's what we called, right? The voltage divider resistance. But that, how did we take care of it? By making that much larger than RS, the source resistance. And we also had some RD here. In this case, in fact, we can't even make it much larger than RL. Most of the time, we can't do that because then that will need a very large supply voltage. So, you just have to live with it. So, when I say you combine this with that, you are allowed some extra components, but try to, of course, minimize that. And if at all you have to put that, try to make sure that their values are such that they don't interfere with the signal picture as much as possible. Okay? So, please tell me what I would do with this. I mean, you can't have another common source amplifier and say, hey, there's my amplifier and I go. No, that's not. No. Let's try to do it with one transistor, we'll get to that later. Yeah, that's possible also. So let's go step by step. I have the input source that has to get connected between gate and source. Okay? So how would I go about doing that? Connected. How? I can do this. Is that okay? And how about the load? Does it work? Ringtone Krishna? This work? Just look at it and tell me whether it will behave like an amplifier or not. It will? No, why not? Everything is shorted together, right? I mean, if I could do this, I don't even need the amplifier. I could potentially. That way. So that's what we have. And clearly, I mean, in this case, this point and that point, the point where we have the source and load are not connected together, right? This is the signal picture we want. Whereas here, everything is connected together. Okay? So somehow I have to separate that. How do I connect the, what will be the operating point voltage here now at the gate? In fact, for simplicity, let's imagine that RS equals 0. If RS equals 0, what will be the operating point voltage? What is that? Okay. Operating point voltage. I mean, Vi is an incremental source, right? 0 volts. Okay. So basically, in the operating point picture, I just have that. How much current is flowing through M1 there? M1 is off, right? I mean, we'll simply shortcut the whole thing to ground. So this won't work. Okay. So, in fact, we spent at least a couple of classes figuring out how to connect the signal source without disturbing the bias. What did we do? As usual, we assume that the signal frequency is higher than some frequency. The signal is not at DC. So, what should I do? What is that, Deepak? Yeah, it is connected through a capacitor. So, if the capacitor is sufficiently large, then clearly this voltage and that voltage will be the same. C1 will appear like a short circuit, but it won't disturb the DC operating point picture. Because for DC operating points, there is no current flowing through C1 and this I0 will flow through the MOS transistor. Okay? Now exactly the same goes for RL, right? Because even if this side is fixed, so let me remove this part. Even if we had only this one, what is the current through the MOS transistor now? Is it I0? No, it depends on what current is flowing through RL. Okay, so that also doesn't work. So first of all, we have to AC couple the input. Okay, and then how do I connect the load? Yeah, so I need to have, it's exactly, I mean, there's nothing new here. There are no new techniques. This is exactly what we did before as well. Okay? So we have a capacitor C2. So that to make sure that for DC, there is no path for I0 except to go through the transistor. Okay? So for DC, capacitors will become open circuit and we have exactly the same operating point picture as before. Right? Is that correct? Okay. Now, when the signal is applied, if you choose C2 to be large enough, its reactance will be negligible. So, RL will appear directly at the drain. And similarly, the input source will get connected to the gate. Okay? So, you have to AC couple the input source and the load. Okay? That's the whole idea. That's why we came up with those techniques. And of course, this needs the constraint that the signal is at some frequency other than 0. It can't be DC. Okay, so but that's okay, that's a frequently encountered condition and for now we will live with that. Okay, so are we done? Yes? Between? I can't hear the last part, between source and drain. Okay. Will this work? For the operating point, what will be the operating point current in the transistor? I mean, is there a feedback? Leaks out of this, under some circumstances this could work. Okay, meaning there could be appropriate gate source voltage here and then this will have this capacitors. I mean, in general, okay, you don't make circuits of this type where there are only capacitors connected to some node, because you don't know what this voltage is. Okay. Now, of course, you solve physics problems like this, assuming that that total charge on that node is zero or something like that. But you can't guarantee such things. Okay. It could be that for whatever reason there is some charge injected on that node, or even if it is not there initially, it could get in there later by whatever reason. Okay. And then after that, that voltage is changed, and that's all that later. So in general, you don't have, even if you can solve circuits of this type and find that the situation is satisfactory, you don't, you avoid these circuits because you cannot predict what voltage will be here. Okay, the same goes here. But also in this case, again, we do connect the another capacitor and the input source and so on. Okay. Okay, so if you don't, you mean instead of that you want to connect it like this. Okay, so this will, first of all, you want feedback from drain to gate for DC. Okay, because at the DC operating point you need feedback. So this circuit doesn't work that way at all. Even if it could work with, let's say, absolutely no charge leakage from this node, if you connect the source like this, it will leak into the source, right? Because again, the quiescent voltage at this point will be zero. The transistor will not be biased at all. You understand? Okay, so this will not work. Because if you set VA to zero, you have a resistor here which will discharge this point to zero. Okay? Now, if you didn't have anything, this could possibly work under the right parameter alignment. But the problem is that you can't reliably predict what charge will be here. Okay, when it's an open circuit. So you don't do that. So essentially, when you want DC feedback, you don't have capacitors in that path. That's all, because capacitor blocks DC. No, I mean, it's for setting the operating point that we need feedback. Yeah, possible. Yeah, that we can. That we could do. See, initially we started with the goal of simply setting the operating point of the transistor to I0. Okay. For that reason, we'll sort it. But like I said, any other method will work as long as your circuit ensures that the gate voltage changes in response to the drain voltage and gate voltage increases in the same direction as the drain voltage. Okay? So let me put this, my original bias circuit back. So are we done? This is an amplifier.
Small signal model will have a short amplifier.
Small signal model will still have a short between drain and gate, right? Because I had it to establish the operating point, so that is still there. So how do I fix this? Yeah, so you have to, there should be a short circuit as far as DC is concerned, but no open circuit for signal frequency. So you could have an inductor. Now, as usual, we would prefer to avoid inductors because inductors are very bulky and so on. Okay, but in this particular case, you don't, you could live with a resistor. Okay, let me call it RG. Why will the resistor work in this case?
Because in a DC case, there's no current through the gate.
So in the operating point case, right? So we have this. Earlier we had a short circuit. Okay, now we have this. So is this just as good as a short circuit? In this case, yes, because what is the current flowing into the gate?
Zero.
So clearly, there is no voltage drop across RG, and as VD increases, VG will increase. Okay? So in this case, a resistor will work, and you can choose a sufficiently large resistor. Okay? Is this fine? So what I wanted was a signal picture of this type. Right? But do I have this exactly? What is it that I have? Let me start and explain this whole thing again. This is the operating point picture and my common source amplifier is this. It's implicit that I replace the transistor with its small signal equivalent here. Okay? Now, the input has to be connected between gate and ground. Okay? To do that, without disturbing the operating point, I will use my AC coupling technique. Okay? So this is AC coupling, and using this doesn't disturb the operating point at the gate. Okay? Similarly, to connect the load, I use AC coupling. Again, using AC coupling ensures that the operating point is not disturbed. Okay? But they do have to get connected for signal frequency. So you will find that there will be some constraint on C1 and C2. Okay? But you can always find a value such that, I mean, if you make C1 and C2 sufficiently large, they will behave like short circuits. Okay? And in the signal picture, the drain and gate are not connected to each other. Okay, whereas in the operating point picture they are. So we have to separate them. One possibility is, I mean, the normal thing you think of when you want a short circuit for DC and an open circuit for AC is an inductor. And again, there will be a constraint on the inductor. It has to be sufficiently large. I mean, sufficiently large refers to the frequency as well as the circuit. I mean, with the signal frequency and the circuit conditions, you will have some value. Okay? Then, we don't want to use inductors, but in this case, because no current is flowing through the element in the operating point, we can use a resistor. Okay? If there was some current flowing, you could probably still use a resistor, but there will be a voltage drop across it. Now, there is no fear of even the voltage drop. Okay? So, we can use a resistor and we can make it as large as we please because the current flow is zero. Okay? Is this fine? So at least for the operating point, when we open circuit C1 and C2, the picture remains the same as before. The gate voltage will be the same as drain voltage. Okay? So that part is ensured by this circuit. But the signal picture is not exactly this. What is the extra stuff that we have? What is it? The RG, that resistance. RG. Okay? In fact, there is only one extra component here. Alright, this appears like, okay, we have roughly what we wanted to have. The operating point picture is not disturbed. In the operating point, we have gate voltage following the drain voltage. The signal picture is disturbed somewhat. There is a value, there is some RG. But you intuitively feel that if RG is very large, okay, then it will reduce to an open circuit. Okay, but how large is very large? How large should RG be? Okay, so to evaluate that properly, you have to find V0 by VI. Okay, so please find V0 by VI for this circuit using regular small signal analysis. That is, you replace the MOS transistor with its incremental equivalent and calculate V0 by VI including RG. Okay, and then you will be able to see what is the value of RG that will make it drop out of the picture. Okay?
By VI, what do you get? First, you set up the equations. The easiest thing is a nodal analysis. If you change this to Vi by Rs and Rs in parallel, then you call this V1 and V2, or maybe VGS and VO, you will have these are the, this is the conductance matrix. What is the conductance matrix entry over there? What is it? What's that? GS plus and minus GG. Okay. Here GM minus GG and then GL plus GG. In fact, you could have used exactly the same analysis we did for the common source amplifier with capacitors. You set C1 and C2 to 0, and instead of SCC, you apply GG and you would have got the same thing, right? And what is the source? Here it is, Vi, GS and 0, okay? So, if you can evaluate it, it will come out to be, in the numerator, you have to find V0, so you replace the second column with this, okay? So, what do you get? VIGS times GM minus GG minus, right? So, that is the determinant of this matrix with the second column replaced by the source vector, isn't it? Is it correct or not? Okay. And what is the determinant of the matrix itself? So, this times this minus that, okay? So, the GG square will get cancelled out, that you can see. So, you will have GSGL plus GL times GG plus GG times GS, but the biggest term is likely to be GM times GG, okay? Now, in this particular case, it is probably a little irritating to use conductances, okay? So, if I make the substitutions in terms of resistors, what will I get? I multiply this by Rg, Rs, Rl and the numerator also, right? Product of all resistors. So, what will I get? Gm, Rs, Rl plus, what will this give me? Rg plus Rs plus Rl. Is that correct? All I did was I multiplied both numerator and denominator by the product of all three resistors, okay? The numerator, so by the way, this is V0, this is not V0 by Vi because I have Vi there. So, V0 by Vi is minus, and what do I have there? Gm Rg Rl plus Rl, okay? Is this correct? But now that the solution is here, this is supposed to be a common source amplifier. What is the expected gain? Minus GMRL. Okay. Will this ever reduce to minus GMRL? What miraculous circumstances will we need? Rg is very large. Of course, if you set Rg to infinity, it will become that. But we can't use infinitely large resistor because there will be no bias. Okay. So, what is a real constraint on Rg? It has to be much greater than what? No, it can't, not GmRs, right? That doesn't have dimensions of resistor. Rg has to be much greater than something that has dimensions of resistance. 1 by Gm. How did you get this? I mean, look at the expression and tell me. Well, okay, what? There is something in the numerator, something else in the denominator. What should happen so that you get minus GmRL as the answer? Will you, do you see it from the expression? Yes. When will it happen? Now, which of the terms in the numerator should be dominant? Obviously, if this is the dominant term and that's the dominant term, clearly the ratio will be, so something is off, right? This is RG, yeah. This is RS, RG, yeah. RG should be? Yeah, yeah, that's right. Sorry. This is RL, I think. Is it RL? Yeah, yeah, that's correct. This is RL. So, this has to be dominant and this has to be dominant. In that case, you will get minus GM RL. In fact, if the other is dominant, we will get a different useful circuit which we will see later. Okay. So, we want and then in the denominator, obviously, RG has to be much greater than everything else. I mean, that means that it has to be more than all of those things. Okay? So, which is the constraint? What is the constraint on RG now? I mean, both of them tell you that RG is much more than something. Obviously, the dominant one is which one? GMRS RL. Okay, actually it should be more than the sum of all those things, but you expect that GMRS RL is lot more than any of those individual terms. Okay, in fact you want RG to be much more than GMRS RL plus RS plus RL. Okay, and the numerator tells you that RG has to be much more than 1 by GM. Okay, so if you satisfy this, you would have satisfied this anyway, because 1 by GM is a small number, because this is an amplifier, GMRL is a large number. So, 1 by GM is much smaller than RL. So, if you do satisfy that, that will be automatically satisfied if you have designed the amplifier properly. Okay. So, it works, and as you intuitively expect, if RG is very large, the gain will become minus GMRL. But the point is, I mean, that's okay as a mathematical result to say that RG tending to infinity will make the gain minus GMRL, but that's completely useless in practice, because what is the meaning of connecting an infinitely large resistance? That means that you don't make the connection, but then it really won't work. Okay? So, you have to find a real number. So, RG is much more than this. So, maybe you choose it to be like 20 times or 50 times more than this, it will work. And what that number is also depends on the context. It could be like 500 ohms, it could be 50 mega ohms, who knows? I mean, depends on the level of other resistors, right? So, you have to be first of all able to do circuit analysis, right? This is what I said in the very first class. Circuit analysis is something absolutely essential. We use it, I mean, it's just like addition or subtraction. We have to be able to use it all the time. But I see a lot of you just struggling to carry out the simple calculations. But I mean, I can only assure you that you will be in serious trouble if you don't practice further, that's all. Okay? And I don't want to go on in this vein the whole time, because I want to at least talk about circuits, not go on about why you didn't or did solve something. Okay. So, finally, we do have a common source amplifier with drain feedback, and the circuit looks like this. You need a current source I naught, and that is true in every case where we are setting the bias current in the transistor to some known value. Okay. And it will behave approximately like a common source amplifier. If RG is large, and large we know what that means, it is okay. Now you now know everything. You know how to choose RG as well. Okay. And the capacitor C1 and C2 have to be sufficiently large for them to behave like short circuits. Right? So how large is large? How would you find out? Shavik Mazumdar? Shavik Mazumdar, not here. Yeah. How do I choose C1? How do I choose C1? Jasbir? Yeah. What did we do earlier to choose a capacitor for it to be a short circuit? Yes? Yeah, you. What's that? Effective resistance where? Across the capacitor. Okay. So now, what is the resistance that appears across C1? So I'll set VI to 0. Okay. So what is the resistance that appears across C1? RS. That's it? RS? RS parallel? Why RS plus RG? Well, what about the transistor? That doesn't count for anything. So, it is RS plus, if you look this way between this terminal and ground, there will be some resistance that appears. Okay? And let me call that RN. Okay? Now, if you do assume RG is infinity, there is no resistance there. Okay? But that is not what I want. So, evaluate the value of Rn. Similarly, what is it for C2? What is the constraint for C2? What is the resistance that appears across C2? RL? So, there is something else. If you look back here between these two terminals, there is something. Let me call that R out. Okay? So, clearly, C1 has to be much greater than 1 over omega times Rn plus Rs. And C2 has to be much greater than 1 over omega times RL plus Rout. Okay. So, please calculate Rin and Rout by tomorrow's class. Okay. So, it is just regular small signal analysis. If you do assume RG is infinity, what is the value of Rin? Rin. Rin. If you are looking, RS is not even part of the circuit. Rin is looking that way. If RG is infinity, what will be that? It will be infinity. Okay. And R out looking that way. Also infinity. So, it looks like. Okay. So, you calculate it while considering the value of RG. Okay.